Hello, I'm James Shears, and welcome to our Low Carbon Fit Out Conversations. This is where we bring together experts in sustainability from across the fit out industry to talk about how we can achieve a low carbon fit out future. Today we've got Becky Gordon from Interface, and we're going to be talking about circularity and its connection with the low carbon future. Hi, Becky.
Hi, James. Thanks for having me.
No, welcome. Why don't you start off by kind of introducing yourself, telling us a bit about yourself?
So I'm Becky and I am the Regional Sustainability Manager at Interface. Interface are a global flooring manufacturer. We make carpet tiles, LVT and rubber flooring. And I'm the Regional Sustainability Manager for the UK, Ireland and Middle East region. And what I do is I engage both internally with my colleagues and also externally with the wider built environment about all things sustainability.
Fantastic. And how did you get into sustainability? What's your background?
So I've got a little bit of a wiggly path into sustainability. So I actually started in our commercial team. I've been with Interface for about 13 years now, and I've worked in various roles, both in the sales and marketing teams. As I worked at Interface, I started to get more and more interested in sustainability and what that meant for a big corporate organisation. And Interface actually supported me to do a course at Cambridge University in sustainable value chains.
Great.
And following that, I then moved into the sustainability team.
So today we're here to talk about the circular economy and its connection. So I suppose the big question is, what is the circular economy?
It's a really good question, because I think the circular economy can be described quite simply in that you are moving from a linear system that takes resources from the earth, makes a product, and then has waste at the end where that product is thrown away into landfill. It's moving from that to a system where you're taking that line and turning it into a circle. So you're effectively creating a circle with no waste, because the waste at the end of life of the product becomes the raw materials for the product to be made again and again. But that's really simplistic, and I think in reality, the circular economy is much more complex than that. There's lots of different avenues you can go down rather than that pure closed-loop recycling. So you can look at things like reuse, so reusing that product again as the same product, or things like repurposing. So that might be turning it into a different product of the same value, or it could even be repurposing it into products of lower value. So I think there's lots of different options when we're thinking about the circular economy, but essentially it's thinking about the whole life cycle of a product rather than just the start or the end. It's thinking about what we put into the product and then also what can happen to it at the end of life.
I think that's the really key bit. It can be incorporated across the built environment, across our projects. So it's not just a standalone thing. It can be incorporated everywhere. I think that's the thing we really need to kind of work out how we can do. We incorporate it everywhere we can.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's a thing that you can look at on a project basis, but it's also something that manufacturers can look at with individual products. So everybody working within the built environment has a role that they can play in moving towards a more circular economy.
Great. So obviously these conversations are all around net zero and carbon. So why are we talking about circularity? What is the connection between circularity and the low carbon future?
Again, a really good question, because I think a lot of the time when we're having conversations on sustainability, we like to separate those two topics. We like to have a conversation on circular economy, and we like to have a separate conversation on carbon. And actually, in reality, they're really linked. A lot of the time, if you start to think about the circularity of a project, you're also likely to be reducing the carbon footprint of that project as well. And it's the same with products. So if we look at what we've done at Interface, if we think about the circularity of the product, so what raw materials we're making the product from, if we think about making those more circular, so for us that would be looking at using recycled raw materials or bio-based raw materials, quite often if we switch to those alternative materials, they actually have a lower carbon footprint. So in thinking circular and trying to make the products more circular, we're actually lowering the footprint of the product as well. Now, it's not 100% of the time that that happens, but generally they are really linked. If you're considering one, you're also going to be having an impact on the other. And that features at end of life as well. So throwing a product into landfill at the end of its life is the highest carbon footprint thing you can do with that product at the end of its life. Whereas if you think about alternative things, so could you reuse that product? could you recycle that product? They have lower carbon footprints than throwing it in landfill. So it all mixes together and it's all one, really.
And it's a win-win exactly. For both. So I know that the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, so one of the key bodies looking into circular economy, have seen that by focusing on circularity, so keeping materials kind of in the cycle, by using less materials and by regenerating nature, within the built environment, we can actually reduce the emissions associated with our materials by 38% just by focusing on circularity. So it has a real big impact. And yeah, they really are interconnected.
They are, and I think there's so many examples out there of cool products that do cool things. There's a company called Biome who work with mycelium-based products, so products that originate from fungi. They're looking at creating insulation panels and things like that, so using sort of natural materials to create products. There's also a company called Made of Air, and they do really cool things with products that are made from pyrolysis and, again, have really sort of high levels of recycled and bio-based content.
Fantastic. So have you seen over the last few years an increase in the interest in circular economy and the interest from your clients in kind of pushing the circularity within your products?
Definitely. I think the last 5 years, there's been a really big shift towards making projects on the whole more circular. We've had more conversations about reusing some of our products. So it might be that if one of our clients is refurbishing their office space, they might take some of their existing flooring that they've had in a front of house area and put that in maybe a lower impact space, so like a server room or a storage space. So reusing that product rather than buying new product for the entire space. And I think it's really interesting when we look at the drivers of becoming more circular. So why are the clients wanting to shift in that direction? And I think there's a few different sort of reasons, and you're probably seeing the same from your clients, but there is a drive for businesses just to be doing better, doing the right thing. And I think that an office space is a really good place for a company to start because it's really tangible. Their employees are walking on the flooring, they're sitting on the furniture. It creates some really nice talking points for them. But it also feeds into their sustainability reporting. So we have quite a lot of our clients that will want data on how much of their old flooring has been taken back into our re-entry take-back program. Or it might be carbon data in terms of the carbon footprint of the products they're using. But all of that can feed back into their sustainability reporting.
We're kind of seeing a similar thing within the fit-out market with our clients, really beginning to not just look at kind of certifications like BREEAM, but actually looking at the detail and especially circular economy. We've had recently a few that are not just focused on our project as it is, but they're looking at how they can reuse what's existing, but they're looking at the end of life now as well, which I think is a key thing that has been missed for a while. So we've been looking into things like deconstruction guides. So the end of the life, how can we ensure that this space is be able to be deconstructed?
Yeah, and I think the end of life is really important, and it's becoming increasingly important with our clients, both on the end user side, but also architects and designers thinking a little bit more about the products that they're specifying and not just the sort of sustainability information for that install and sort of the impact today, but also at end of life, when the designer's got nothing to do with that project anymore, what can happen to it at the end of life?
I think you touched on a really important bit there about the designers kind of considering and looking into it. And I know a really important bit is to really think about circularity really early on. So looking at doing pre-refurbishment audits, what's existing and what's coming out, so what can we reuse? But then also the materials that are actually going in. So what do you think is really important when specifying materials? What should designers or project teams be thinking about in terms of the materials to make sure that they are circular?
Yeah, I think it's a really difficult task. If you're a designer, if you're an interior designer or an architect, to think about what materials to select and what data to look at, because there's so much out there in terms of certifications and labels that are on products to say that they're eco this or they're green, they're sustainable. And it can be a little bit of a difficult task to cut through that. But if you're thinking about circularity, you need to think about that full life cycle of the product. So there's some key data that you can look for that gives you an indication, regardless of labels, of the impact that that product has. So the first thing I would always say to look at if you're specifying a new product is what's going into that product. So what materials is it made from? Does it have high levels of recycled content or bio-based content? So we're starting with the best materials possible. You then think about how that product's made, so the carbon impact of that. So usually we would say to look at the cradle to gate carbon footprint, which is on an EPD, the A1 to A3 value. But for anyone who's not super like up on the sustainability terms, that just means the raw materials, the transport of those materials to the factory, and then the actual production of the product itself. And you can that data can be calculated really accurately. So if you look at that, that gives you a good indication of the carbon footprint of that product. But then you've also got to consider the end of life. So we can't just think about the impact on install. We need to think about the impact further down the line. And the way to do that is to look at whether that product has good end of life options. So is it recyclable? Can it be reused? Is it easy to be reused? And then does the manufacturer have a program to help you do that? Because it's all very well a product being recyclable, for example. But if it's a complex material or product, like a flooring product can be very complicated in its construction. If you don't have a take-back program from the manufacturer, it can be really difficult to know how on earth you do recycle it. So I think having those manufacturers or industry-wide schemes is really important to enable that to actually happen at end of life. And if you're considering those few areas, then I think you're getting a really good, complete picture of that product and its impact for its full life cycle.
I think you touched on a really key point there. We need to be thinking about the life cycle of materials and spaces, not just what we're installing now and looking at it at this point, but also the full life cycle and then, of course, its end of life. At the moment, of course, with most projects, we're focused on the construction of the space and not necessarily what's going to happen in the future. So I think that's a key part of circularity. We need to close it. We need to do the circle. So what do you think are some key things we need to consider when thinking about the whole cycle? Is it repairable? Is it kind of deconstructible?
I think interior designers and end user clients have a really important role to play. There's lots of things that they can do to help that space last longer. And obviously with circularity, we want that space to last as long as possible before those materials get taken up. And then when they do get taken up, we want there to be something to happen to those materials other than them just being sent to landfill. So when we're advising clients, when thinking about reusing or recycling the end of life of a project, we talk about how they're designing that floor. So there's a few things you can think of. So, for example, don't necessarily use trend colours on the floor. So stick to quite neutral colours because they're likely to last longer and they're likely to not need changing as often. Whereas if you go for really trendy colours, in a few years' time, it might look a little bit dated.
Yeah.
Then there's other things with patterns. So if you imagine a carpet tile, you can get very plain carpet tiles, but you can also get very patterned carpet tiles. And if you go for something that is more patterned, and especially if it's an organic pattern to it, it will hide marks and wear a lot better than a plain product. And also we have some products that are called random design, which means that there's no set installation method for those products, which means that in theory, you can take up one tile, replace it with a brand new one if the original one was damaged, and it will blend right in. And that can help extend the longevity of the project.
You don't need to replace the whole floor.
Exactly. You can just replace individual tiles and it won't look like an awful patchwork quilt that you imagine 80s carpet tiles looking like. Now it can look a lot better. It's designed so that the products will look better for longer. And I think by putting in those design principles to the design stage of a project means that you'll get more use out of that product. And then at the end of life, it's more likely that those products will be able to be reused, which ultimately is what we want from the products, for them to be reused at end of life.
Of course. I mentioned earlier about deconstruction guides, and that's one thing that we're looking at. It's a key thing for the contractors to be able to develop for our clients. So I think it can be incorporated into our O&Ms to actually say, this is what we've installed, but this is how to take it apart. And I think we're going to be working closely with suppliers like yourselves to really understand what's the best way of putting these items in, and so what is the easiest way for us to take it out. And then, again, as you said, that's going to really help get to the optimum part of circularity, which is, of course, reuse. Because reuse really is that central part of circularity. We talked about carbon reduction, and by reusing a material, you're not going to be creating the embodied carbon of sourcing new raw materials and manufacturing it. You're going to be using it again. And I think that's a real key thing. And we've been looking at this for quite some while on how we can reuse things, and it's beginning to get easier. But I still think it's quite niche. Reuse. We've mentioned we really need client buy-in and we need designer buy-in. I think that's really key with reuse. What do you think are the key ways we can get reuse more mainstream in our projects?
I think it's difficult because it really depends on the product or material that you're looking at. So if you're looking at products like furniture or flooring, there are schemes already out there that you can take advantage of. So there's loads of companies that will refurbish furniture, and either you can use that on the project that you're working on, or it could go to charities and organisations like that. Same for flooring. So Interface have a take-back programme that we call re-entry. Mm-hmm. And with our carpet tiles, the first thing that we look to do with those products that are coming back at end of life is reuse them.
Great.
So we work with partner organisations across the UK who then take the product from us and sell that at really low cost, usually into housing associations and charities. So it doesn't just have the sort of carbon footprint impact that you mentioned, but it also has a social impact, which I think is really important because, you know, we can talk about environmental sustainability, but it has to go hand in hand with social sustainability as well. So having that social impact, ensuring that people that wouldn't necessarily be able to buy a nice new carpet can have reused carpet tiles in their space, which means that they're going to be warmer, they're going to be comfier for your kids to run around on, and all over just create a better environment in those spaces. So there's already schemes out there for certain products, but then I think for other products, it is a little bit more of a challenge and it's more innovation. But the key is always going to be collaboration. We need manufacturers to collaborate with others in the industry and end-user clients to make sure that end-of-life and reuse is being thought about, because you need everyone working together to actually make things happen.
Yeah.
So we can have an amazing take-back scheme. You can specify with the intention and build with the intention of reuse at the end of life. But ultimately, neither of us are usually involved at that product's end of life or that project's end of life. So that collaboration with the end user client as well is really important. And if every actor in the sort of value chain puts their heads together and really thinks about this, there's a lot of solutions that already exist.
So from what I understand from you, collaboration is key. And would you say early action is key as well? We need to be thinking about this before the project's even designed. We need to really be thinking about reuse from the start. Can we reuse things in situ? Can we send things, as you said, to good causes for reuse? I think that's really key for us to ensure that it is circular and it is sustainable.
Yeah, I think if you're waiting till further down the project, it can be too late to bring in those ideas that usually involve a little bit of innovation and a little bit of collaboration between different organisations.
Yeah.
So the earlier you can think about that, the better, which is why the end user client is key.
Absolutely.
Because getting them involved and getting them bought into the idea of circularity is really, really important.
Circularity isn't just one person's responsibility. It's everyone's. It's kind of holistic.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So, Becky, the final and million-dollar question. If you could change one thing within the industry to ensure that we could achieve a net-zero carbon future, what would you do?
It is a huge question, because there's lots of little things that need to change, definitely.
Of course.
But for me, I think one of the biggest challenges is that it is not necessarily a simple task for a designer to select a sustainable product, however you are defining sustainability. And that's made more complicated by the amount of certifications and labels
Absolutely.
That exist that don't necessarily give a fully transparent picture behind that product. So you can get a sticker for your product that says it's XYZ or says it's green or eco, and designers rely on that when it's not really digging into the data. Now, certifications aren't necessarily a bad thing. They can be good and they can help guide. But the amount of variety there is in the market makes it really difficult. So when I'm speaking to architects and designers, they are finding it a challenge to really cut through and work out what data it is they're meant to be looking at,
yeah,
or what certifications are credible. And I think having less certifications or more transparency from the manufacturers around data such as recycled content, bio-based content, having an EPD for your products, having that transparency so that designers and architects can really make good, solid choices when selecting products rather than doubting themselves that something might be greenwash or might not be accurate. I think that would help the industry move forward significantly.
So consistency is key. You want to be able to compare like for like rather than one certificate saying this, but the other one looking at slightly different things. I completely agree. And we talk to a lot of our manufacturers and they say the similar thing. There's so many certificates out there and everyone wants a slightly different one. There should be some consistency.
Yeah, definitely. I think it would help the industry move forward. It would help people make really smart decisions on the products that they're specifying.
Great. Well, thank you, Becky. It's been fantastic having you in today to talk about circularity and net zero. So thank you for your time.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us today for our low carbon fit out conversation all around the circular economy. The full video is available on YouTube or Spotify or wherever you get your podcasts. And please give us a like and a follow. Thanks so much for listening and keep an ear out for our next conversation.